So I read about, and through the news, all that was going on back in my country as we went through this transition. And I decided it was time that I needed to go back to my native land and to do what I can. Went back to Chittagong University. I headed up the economics department at Chittagong. And during that period of time, I had now become very knowledgeable of economics. And I was able to give all of these elegant economic theories to my students in Bangladesh. We looked out the window. People were dying. So what good were all of my great economic theories if right outside on our doorsteps people were dying? And I made a decision that we needed to do something. So I took my whole class and we headed into the villages of Bangladesh to see what could be done. We went to study the challenges of poverty, of hunger. Our country has horrible weather, we have famine, we have all of these challenges when people are dying. We started to connect with various people in the village. And I came across a lady who was making bamboo stools. And I talked to her. And she said that she'd been making bamboo stools for years. And she was only making 2 cents a day out of bamboo stools. And I said, why? She says, well, I can't afford to buy the raw materials. And so I have to buy the raw materials from someone who charged me an exorbitant interest rate. I then take and make the stools, and then I'm forced to sell those stools back to this same guy. And for years now, I've been making 2 cents a day making bamboo stools. And I said to her, well, what would it take? What would it take for you to change a cycle? To get the raw materials that you didn't have to pay an exorbitant interest rate back. And the answer was 80 cents. 80 cents for her to change the cycle. I was taken aback. And I had my students then go into the village and talk to more people. And we came up with 42 people who, if they had a cumulative $27 could work their way out of poverty. I said, for $27, take it out of my pocket and loan these folks some money. I did that. We continued to work with them. We talked to them about how to do business. And lo and behold, within a year, it all paid the money back. So we continued to look at that, and I then started going to the banks, and I said, you know, these people, the poorest, all they need is a little bit of money. Won't you loan them some money? I said, well, where's their collateral? Where's their contracts? You know how banks work. I said, well, they have no collateral. They don't speak English. They can't do anything. But they're capable of doing businesses. They're little mini entrepreneurs, and all they need is a little bit of capital. So I continued to loan more money, and we went through this cycle, and they said, you've only done it in one village, and we did it in a number of villages. And we replicated, and I went back to the banks, and the banks said, no, and they said, okay, if you want some money from the bank, you personally have got to sign for collateral on it. I said, okay, and I signed thousands of individual loans and collateral. Lo and behold, people paid the money back. I went back to the banks. They still said, you've got to pay the collateral or you've got to sign each note. And finally, it got so big that we decided we need to do something bigger. Here we were, loaning now large amounts of money. They were all being paid back in typically a year. The loans were typically $100 or so. People were starting to lift themselves out of poverty. If finally I went to the government and I said, okay, you know, the banks won't work. We need to create a new banking system. And I'm prepared to do that. And the government said, okay. And we worked through and we got a new banking system. And it was called the Grameen Bank, the Village Bank. And with that then, we started to try and understand how this system worked and how to make it work most efficiently. And we found a number of things. We found that it didn't make any difference whether there was collateral or not. These people were responsible people. We formed them into groups, typically five individuals in a group. And it was the peer pressure within the group that assured that the money would be repaid. Whereas you, if your banking system in the United States, you expect them all to come to your doors. Our bankers went to them on their bicycles. They went once a week. And once a week they would meet with the individuals and go through and determine how their business was going, help them with how to handle money. We didn't help them with how to run a business. You know, all these people really got their own little entrepreneurial thing that they're quite capable of doing. But we helped them, and we set up a system that we met with them weekly, and they paid the money back. We also learned over time that if we loaned money to women, we would get a very high rate of payback. Women knew how to take care of the family. They had their priorities. They were concerned about education. The men weren't always that good. So Grameen Bank, in its existing form, has now loaned out a total of $6 billion.
Wow.
$6 billion to 7 million people. 97% of them are women. And 99.2% of it is paid back on time. Paid back on time. And one of the things that's happened, and the reason that we're doing this, is to lift people out of poverty. And at this point in time, 64% of the people who have borrowed money from Grameen Bank have lifted themselves out of poverty. Now you might say, well, what do you mean by out of poverty? And people talk about anyone who earns a dollar a day is the poorest of $2 a day or unimportant. Those measures are meaningless. We have 10 criteria associated with getting out of being in poverty. They include things like 3 meals a day for all the family. They include clothes for all the family. It includes being able to take care of your medical bills. It includes things like clean latrines, clean water. There are a roof over our head, a bed to sleep on. There are 10 things that make that difference as to whether you've really emerged out of poverty. We then took this, and people then started to become interested in it around the world. We've now expanded the program into 100 different countries. There are a variety of other organizations that have their own systems associated with doing that. And the Rotary Club has become a very major element of this.